Hello physicists, welcome back to Z Physics. Today we are going to be revising all of cosmology. Well, let's get started. Let's get started with some units. First off, an astronomical unit is the average distance from the Sun to the Earth. This is about 150 million kilometers, or 1.5 times 10 to the power of 11 meters in standard form. Additionally, we need to remember that a light year is the distance traveled by moving at the speed of light for a year. Just be careful, remember it's a unit of distance. Additionally, we can calculate one light year just simply by multiplying the speed of light by the amount of seconds in a year, which is going to give us 3 times 10 to the power of 8, 365 days, 24 hours each, 60 minutes times 60 seconds, and that will give us 9.5 times 10 to the power of 15 meters. Also, let us remind ourselves of some smaller measurements of angles. So first off, an arc minute is 1/60th of a degree, and one arc second is 1/60th of that, which brings us to 1 over 3,600th of a degree. Let's remind ourselves of what a parallax is. In order to determine the distances to nearby stars, so let's imagine that we have a little nearby star just over here. The way astronomers can figure out the distance from the Earth to this star is with a technique known as the stellar parallax. Astronomers are going to take pictures of this star against the background of distant stars, as you can see over here on the right. They will take essentially a couple of pictures 6 months apart, once when the orbit of the Earth is here and once when the Earth is on the opposite side over here. They'll be able to see the star shifting its apparent position with respect to the background of distant stars. All they need to do is essentially half this angular displacement over here to get the parallax angle P. Normally these parallax angles are incredibly small and they have the order of a few arc seconds. Now, because this is the distance from the Earth to the Sun, the length of this side over here will be one astronomical unit. So I'm just going to write this down. This is going to be one astronomical unit. One parsec is defined as the distance at which one astronomical unit subtends a parallax angle of one arc second. So essentially in our parsec triangle, if this distance here is one astronomical unit, if this parallax angle is one arc second, let's be a little bit more precise even, it's 1 over 3,600th of a degree, then the distance, this side over here, is going to be one parsec. So I'm going to write this as PC just to differentiate it from a parallax, which has already reserved the letter P. Using this parsec triangle, using simple trigonometry, we can calculate the amount of meters in a parsec. So let's do this. I'm just going to remove the background of distant stars so we can zoom in a little bit better and have a go at this. Okay, well, let's use the function tan because we are given the adjacent and we're given the opposite component of this right hand triangle. So all I'm going to say is that the tan of the parallax angle P is going to equal to opposite divided by adjacent. So tan of the parallax angle, which is one arc second, 1 over 3600 will be equal to our opposite, which is one astronomical unit divided by one parsec, which is our adjacent. So this means that one parsec will be equal to one astronomical unit divided by the tangent of 1 over 3,600 degrees. One astronomical unit is 1.5 times 10 to the power of 11. Then I'm going to divide that by the tan of this number. So tan of 1 over 3,600. And if we put this into a calculator, we're going to get up to two sig figs, about 3.1 times 10 to the power of 16 meters. So one parsec is equal to this value. Right, next up on the spec is the cosmological principle. This states that the universe is both isotropic, homogeneous, and the laws of physics are universal. Isotropic means that the universe appears the same in all directions. Homogeneous means that the universe, as far as we can tell, seems to have a constant matter density. Right, next up is the Doppler shift equation. In fact, there are two equations, delta lambda over lambda is equal to V over C, but additionally, we could also write down that delta F over F is also equal to V over C. Notice that in this case, delta lambda is the change of wavelength, lambda is the original wavelength as measured in the lab, or the original frequency as measured in the lab. V is the recession speed, C is the speed of light. The quantity which astronomers refer to as a redshift is this ratio of V over C. Often they would just give it a percentage, so it could be 60% or just could be a decimal, such as let's say 0.6, etc. Let's apply this to a little problem over here. We have that the wavelength of an element is measured as 500 nanometers in the lab. The same signature wavelength is measured as 12 nanometers longer in a red-shifted galaxy. Let's calculate the recession speed. An excellent starting point for this question would be just simply to write down the Doppler shift equation and then rearrange for the recession speed. So what I'm going to write is delta lambda over lambda is equal to V over C. Then rearranging for the recession speed V, we get that V will be equal to delta lambda divided by lambda multiplied by the speed of light C. Now delta lambda is the change in wavelength. In this case, if it's measured as the wavelength is measured as 12 nanometers longer, our change in wavelength will be equal to 12. Our original wavelength is 500 nanometers. Notice if I had written times 10 to the power of minus 9 here and here, they would just cancel out. So I'll just leave it as that. Then I'm going to multiply by the speed of light, which is 3.0 times 10 to the 8. Meters per second, and if we put that into a scientific calculator, we are going to get 7.2 times 10 to the power of 6 meters per second. The recession speeds tend to be absolutely huge, by the way, so don't be worried about getting some pretty large numbers such as this one. Right, on to Hubble's law next. This states that the recession speed of a distant galaxy is directly proportional to its distance from the Earth. I've underlined the word galaxy because it's quite a common mistake to omit this in a definition when answering exam questions, and you may be you may lose some marks because of this, because Hubble's law only applies to distant galaxies. Only one galaxy really is coming towards us, and this is Andromeda because it's gravitationally bound and to the Milky Way. Anyways, so you can see a graph of the speed, the recession speed of the galaxies in kilometers per second against distance in megaparsecs. And you can clearly see this straight line proportionality, this straight line linear relationship. Hubble's law is summarized with the equation that the recession speed is equal to H naught, which is Hubble's constant, multiplied by the distance d. Let's perform y equals mx plus c analysis on the following graph. Remember, if we were to plot v on the y-axis as shown. If we had the distance on the x-axis, what will be left for our gradient is h naught. Additionally, as we can see, our intercept c is going to be 0, which means that our graph is expected to be a straight line through the origin. So our gradient is in fact Hubble's constant. Now, we are going to need to remember how to convert Hubble's constant from non-standard units to SI units. For instance, because the units on this graph are kilometers per second and megaparsecs on the x-axis, Hubble's constant will be given in kilometers per second per megaparsecs, per megaparsec. A typical value for Hubble's constant will be, let's say, about 70 kilometers per second per megaparsec. The SI units of Hubble's constant are time raised to the power of minus 1, so it'll be s to the power of minus 1. Now, let's see how to convert them to SI units. In order to convert the 70 kilometers per second per megaparsec, let's examine this. So I'm going to have the base value of 70. Now, kilo is not in base units, so I'm going to have to multiply this by 10 to the power 3 meters per second. This is all fine. However, a megaparsec is not in SI units. So I have a megaparsec raised to a power of minus 1. So this means that I'm going to need to divide by the conversion factor of the parsec. Now, first off, because it's a megaparsec, mega stands for 10 to the power of 6, and one parsec is 3.1 multiplied by 10 to the power of 16 meters. And if we put this expression into a calculator, we are going to get approximately 2.26 multiplied by 10 to the power of minus 18 seconds to the power of minus 1, which is the SI unit of Hubble's constant. And remember that once we have Hubble's constant in SI units, we can calculate the age of the universe. The age of the universe is 1 over Hubble's constant in SI units. So in this case, this will give us 1 over 2.26 multiplied by 10 to the power of minus 18. And plugging this into a calculator, we are going to get 4.42 multiplied by 10 to the power of 17 seconds for the age of the universe. Now, how many years is that? In order to convert the number of seconds to years, all we need to do is divide this number by the amount of seconds in a year. So what I'm going to do is write down 4.42 times 10 to the power of 17 seconds divided by 365 days, each of them 24 hours, each of them 60 minutes, each of them 60 seconds. And if we put that into a calculator, we're going to get 1.4 times 10 to the power of 10 years. Remember, 10 to the 9 is a billion, so that's going to be 14 billion years. And there we have it. That's the age of the universe. And now that we have calculated the age of the universe, this naturally brings us to the model of the expanding universe supported by the redshift of galaxies, also supported by Hubble's law, which tells us that the faster those galaxies are going, the more further away they are from us. Well, let's have a look at the Big Bang theory in some detail. So let's revise what we need to know about the Big Bang theory. First off, the very moment of the Big Bang, time and space are created. Straight after that, really early, 10 to the power of minus 35 seconds, the universe starts to expand rapidly in a period known as inflation. The expansion at that stage is non-linear. Straight after that, 10 to the power of minus 6 seconds, the first fundamental particles, things such as leptons, for instance, and quarks, start to gain mass. This is with a process that is not very well understood, involving the Higgs boson, and quarks will eventually bind to form hadrons, which are particles such as protons and neutrons. As the universe is expanding, it is also cooling down. And at about 380,000 years after the Big Bang, the universe is now cool enough for atoms to form. As the nuclei capture electrons, they go down energy levels, and a huge amount of EM radiation at this stage is released, which then becomes known as the cosmic microwave background radiation. As we said, the EM radiation that was released during this time, which is actually known as the recombination time if you guys do physics at university, is known as the cosmic microwave background radiation. And this is one of the main observational pieces of evidence for the Big Bang theory. This radiation was initially released as a high energy gamma rays, however, due to the expansion of the universe, has been stretched to microwaves. Additionally, it accounts for a temperature of 2.7 Kelvin. A really useful analogy to think about it is you can almost think about it as the birth echo of the universe. And finally, let us talk briefly about dark matter and dark energy. Starting off with dark matter, when scientists started observing the rate of rotation of galaxies, it became clear that there was a major discrepancy between the observed speed of rotation of galaxies versus the predicted speed. As we can see, the observed speed was considerably higher than what was initially predicted. The only way that this could be explained was if in a galaxy there is a lot more that we can't actually see, that there appears to be a halo with more matter all around a galaxy. This exotic dark matter seems to interact via the gravitational interaction, so we can see the effect of gravity. It's keeping the galaxies together, it's causing them to rotate at the required speed that we are observing. However, we can't see it. It doesn't seem to be heating up or emitting any radiation, which leads us to believe that it's an exotic particle that we don't know the name of, and we hide our ignorance by giving it a cool name such as dark matter. Finally, let us talk briefly about dark matter and dark energy. Starting off with dark matter, when scientists started observing the rate of rotation of galaxies, it became clear that there was a major discrepancy between the observed speed of rotation of galaxies versus the predicted speed. As we can see, the observed speed was considerably higher than what was initially predicted. The only way that this could be explained was if in a galaxy there is a lot more that we can't actually see, that there appears to be a halo with more matter all around a galaxy. This exotic dark matter seems to interact via the gravitational interaction, so we can see the effect of gravity. It's keeping the galaxies together, it's causing them to rotate at the required speed that we are observing. However, we can't see it. It doesn't seem to be heating up or emitting any radiation, which leads us to believe that it's an exotic particle that we don't know the name of, and we hide our ignorance by giving it a cool name such as dark matter. Finally, let us talk a little bit about dark energy. That is the energy of empty space, which seems to fuel the expansion of the universe. It is incredibly mysterious. In fact, I urge you guys to go beyond the scope of the specification and to have a look at a video, which I have given a link in the description down below for both more information on dark matter and dark energy. Other than that, this was our revision video on A-level cosmology. Thank you very much for tuning in, guys. If you have found this video useful, remember to smash the like button, and hopefully I will see you in the next video. Thank you very much for watching.